Hi there, everybody. It's me, Punky. Magellan has forced, asked me to give you the lowdown on how to play Horizons. The goal of the game is to get through 5 different stages. In each one, there's a task you'll have to perform. They won't be easy, and you'll die a lot, and you have to complete them before your timer runs out, or you have to start that stage all over again. You have to get through all 5 stages successfully in order to save Tyra from becoming a cyborg slave to the evil Dr. Talpa. I can't think of anything worse than being a robot slave to someone. Not that I would know anything about that.
I can hear you.
Okay, anywho. Horizons is different from previous games in that you can enter all the areas either as a player or just as an observer, or as we call it, an explorer. The most obvious difference between explorers and players is explorers are allowed to fly. That doesn't mean they are immune, though. Explorers can still be killed by most of the perils in Horizons. They just can't interact with quest items or get credit for getting to the end. You can tell an explorer from a player by the color of the indicator that they're wearing. So, let's say you don't want to be an explorer, and you want to play. That means you're going to need one of these things. This is a Horizons player HUD. Ooh, isn't it pretty? The basic HUD is divided into 4 main parts. The top half has quest progression indicators, the countdown timer, and buttons for help and home. Home is the main Horizons home base. Click on the yellow button with the house icon to instantly teleport back there at any time. The red button with the question mark is a help button. Click on that if you're one of those bookwormy types that like to read the instructions. Yeah, that button really doesn't get used very much. The countdown timer is fairly self-explanatory. It shows how much time you have left once you start each quest. When it reaches 0, time is up and you have to start over. The progression indicators light up brightly once you complete a quest, are dimly lit showing which quests you are currently working on, and are dark for quests that you have yet to complete. Simple, yeah? The bottom half of the HUD is the status update window. It provides helpful information on what you need to do next. If you find it blocks your view, click on it and it just tucks itself away. Click on it again and you can see what the last message was. Finally, there is a mute button if you get tired of hearing Magellan nagging you as you play.
What?
Sorry, sir, can't hear you.
I said, what did you say?
I said I had the mute button on. Sorry, can't hear you.
Why?
Your lips are moving, but nothing's coming out.
I'm gonna
To be fair, though, Magellan does have some helpful advice sometimes. Sometimes if you pretend you can't hear him, he can't tell the difference. So, where were we? Oh, yeah. In the Horizons home base, you start out in the landing zone, where you are asked if you want to be a player or explorer. Following the path, you pass the video kiosks and go down to the crossroads, where you can turn left and see the payout stations, turn right to use the portals that take you directly to any of the quests, or if you're ready to suffer a horrible, untimely demise, just go straight ahead and enter the first quest. At the beginning of each quest, you will see 3 things. First is a HUD kiosk. If you lose your HUD or need to get a new one for any reason, get within 5 meters of the kiosk and touch it. You will be given a new HUD set to the proper point in your quest progress. The second thing you will see is the quest info kiosk. Touching that gives you a note card and info on what you will need to do to complete the quest. The third and most important thing you will see is the quest gate. Walking through this gate is the official start of the quest, and this is what starts your HUD countdown timer. Okay, so, the quests. Quest number 1, the Canyons. First quest takes place in the Badland Canyons. There are groups of robots all over the canyon. You need to find the ones with the key card. They are the ones with the yellow light. Get close enough to click on them before they pass the card to another robot in the group. Once you have it, make your way to the access terminal near the mines and touch it to finish the quest. Oh, did I mention the poisonous mechanical beetles? The toxic water, the sand traps, splorches, and the hidden razor-sharp slicers that pop out of the ground without warning and chop you into itty-bitty, teeny-weeny, tiny-little, little bit of bits? Oh wait, I think I just did. Huh? What's that? What's a splorch? Oh, you'll find out. Oh, yes. You'll find out. Oh, my. I don't know why I laughed like that. It must be Dr. Talpa's mind control. Yeah, that's it. And we're moving on to quest number 2, the mines. Let's suppose for one second that you survive the first quest. You will then find yourself in the entrance to the next level, the mines. First thing you will notice is an extra mini HUD with three red lights on it. They represent the three types of electrical components you need to find. A capacitor, a resistor, and a vacuum tube. Parts are strewn all over the floor of the mine, but most of them are junk. I mean, come on, they've been sitting on the floor of a mine. How good could they possibly be? Once you do find a good capacitor, resistor, and vacuum tube, go to the circuit board and try to fix the wires. If you are successful, find the access terminal at the exit from the mines and touch it to end the quest within the allotted time. Easy peasy, no? No. But if you do make it, this leads you to the third quest. Quest number three, the forest. It takes place in a beautiful forest filled with not as beautiful killer robots. As you enter, you get yet another mini HUD. The top half is your health meter. If that meter turns red and gets all the way empty, you are DEB dead and are sent back to the resurrection circle. But you can fight back. As you walk through the quest gate, you're also given a very special ray gun. It's the only type of weapon that can destroy the killer robots. Pressing M on your keyboard should put you in a mouse look mode. That little box in the center is your crosshairs. Aim it at the robots and fire by left clicking your mouse. Take that, toaster face! Yeah! There's a little bit of reload time, and it's a good idea not to stay in one spot too long. When the robots explode, they drop mechanical parts. That's where the second half of the mini HUD comes in. When it flashes, you have all the components that you need. You'll need to collect 10 of those parts total to fix the access terminal at the end of the quest. But watch out, looks can be deceiving. Remember those pretty trees? Yeah, sometimes they explode and kill everybody around them instantly. Gee, thanks, Dr. Talpa. Quest number four, the swamp. Once you get through the forest, you'll find yourself on a bridge over the toxic swamp. Oh, goody, a bridge over the toxic swamp. No. Well, it would be if Dr. Talpa didn't have his sea monster robot pet Fluffy destroy it and guard the way from intruders. Someone once told me that the name Fluffy is an acronym or something. I think it might be the first things people say when they meet her, except all the F's are all dirty. Anyway, in this quest, you once again get a mini HUD. The goal is not just to get across the swamp. You have to first find Dr. Talpa's Tablet of Terror. Can this guy pick names or what? The mini HUD is a map showing where you are and where your tablet is. Get within a few meters and the tablet will appear. Touch it and it gives you your personal access code. And the mini HUD shows you where the access terminal is. Enter that code at the access terminal correctly and you've completed the quest. But only if you avoid falling into the water and not getting lit up like a Christmas tree by Fluffy. Alright, on to the final stage. Quest 5, the Command Center. This quest has not one task, but four. First, you have to get through the hallway of laser traps. Then, you have to run around the code room and touch all of the numbers to match them on your mini HUD in the proper order while avoiding being shot by the sentry bots. Next, you negotiate a maze of moving walls, again avoiding the sentry bots and the security lasers, which can appear at any time. Finally, you have to make your way walking or jumping through a room with red and green pressure pads. As long as you stay on the green ones, you are fine. But they're constantly changing, and the red ones will explode. If you get caught at any point, you are sent back to the resurrection circle. Clear everything in time, and you finally get to where Tyra is trapped. If you enter the code correctly in the code room, activating the control panel on the stasis field generator will free her. Then, the giant boss monster comes bursting out of the wall with a cheese grater in one hand and a diamond-tipped washcloth in the other, and it's like, bam, 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 and you try to run, but you can't run, you can't hide, and you jump, and you grab the magic spatula, you hit him in the belly button, and... Hello, Mr. Magellan?
Punky, what did the moles tell you about the boss monster?
That it wasn't in the budget.
And what else?
They said that at that point in the game, the players would be teleported back to home base to get their choice of a Random Horizons gift prize or the option number one's daily Linden Dollar prize for residents with accounts that have payment info used.
Is that all?
And as punishment, I had to be your personal assistant and tell them when you were coming to the worksite so they could hide all of their booze so you wouldn't drink it all.
What?
Huh? I didn't hear anything. Did you say something?
Hmm.
See, I told you we can't